Hello and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and our arts calendar.
Tonight's special program entitled Jazz, music from the United States of America to the world with love.
We then proceed to our state of affairs with a conversation with brother Mr. Michael Clifton. So in addition to staying cool, remember you are participating in what else but The Collegium.
Yeah, I was thinking about this the other day and thinking about how I used to be able to run around and do whatever I want to do. Can't do it anymore. Looks like things are moving on. Things are passing me by. Wonder what is gonna happen to me.
Time, where does it come from? And who? I mean, who needs it anyhow? And what? What takes it all away, eh? And where? Where does it all go?
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah. Was it here before I came? And will it be here when I am gone? Then,
who needs it anyway?
I am losing all my time.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah. I'm breathing all my time away. Use it, use it, use it while you may. Use it, use it, use it while you may. Cause it's going gone, going gone, going gone, going gone. Tick-tock, going gone, going gone, going gone, going gone. Tick-tock, 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 tick-tock.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah. Cause it's going. It's going anyway. It's going anyway. Time's up, baby cakes. And I'm
cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Meine Zeit läuft mir davon. Alles fällt so schwer. Freunde? Ich habe nicht mehr sehr viele Freunde. Was bleibt mir noch? Was kann ich noch weitergeben, bevor es zu Ende geht? Meine Zeit läuft mir davon. Zeit. Wo kommt sie her? Wer braucht sie sowieso? Was nimmt sie alles mit? Wohin geht die ganze Zeit?
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Yeah.
War sie hier, bevor ich kam? Wird sie sie da sein, wenn ich geh? Dann gebraucht sie sowieso. Ich verliere meine Zeit.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Atme meine ganze Zeit davon. Nutze sie. Nutze sie. Nutze sie, wenn du kannst. Weil sie vergeht. 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 Tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack. Sie vergeht. Vergeht. Geht. Vergangen. Geht. Vergangen. Geht. Vergangen. Geht. Vergangen. Geht.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Time's up and baby cakes and I am out.
And welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program. We are very pleased this evening to have as guest Mr. Reggie Moore, Mrs. Connie Moore, Fawazi Abdul Khaliq, Mr. Earl Bostic, and Mr. Michael Clifton, along with our regular panelists, Mr. Tema Kadali and Mr. Charles Achie Odong. To begin the informational flow, I'd like to drop the bomb on someone and just ask you, how do you define the term jazz, and what is the relationship of jazz to rhythm and blues, rock and roll, and soul? Who's first?
I got the first bomb.
Michael had the first bomb.
I say my definition of jazz is two criterias, that it must somewhere have spontaneity and improvisation. And it has to swing, and by that I don't mean it has to be a swing beat, but that whatever rhythm it is, that it's got a groove, it's got a swing some way. So that's my feeling on jazz. And the relation, what was it, the...
relation to rhythm and blues?
The relationship to rhythm and blues, soul, rock and roll, is all with the blues, because it all has the blues in it, all these musics with jazz. Jazz is the blues, rock and roll is the blues, rhythm and blues is the blues, everything is the blues.
I'd like to extend that definition just a little bit, because there's some different forms of music that have improvisation and that really swing, I mean that really grooves and you can pat your feet to it, but they come from India, they come from Asia, it's come from other places. So jazz is a specific type of swing, specific type of feel, and it came from the slaves that were brought over to America, and they developed an art form in America. This is the only American art form.
True American art form.
Further comments?
Yeah, each one of these art forms, jazz, rhythm and blues, rock and roll, they all emphasize certain parts because all of them contain improvisation to some extent. All of them contain certain rhythms. Even classical music has syncopation once in a while. But it's what you actually dwell on, what you exploit. Jazz has probably more syncopation than classical music. Jazz might bring out more complex chords in terms of extending the chord up past the 9th, 11th, 13th, flat this and flat that. Although the contemporary classical music has the same thing, jazz dwells more on the rhythm of it. Classical music might hit upon some of these things and go on to something else, and jazz might dwell on a certain beat and stay on it a longer time. Rock and roll might emphasize, and blues might emphasize the backbeat. What is the backbeat? That's the second and fourth beat of 1, 2, 3, 4. Mm-hmm. 1, 2. Really bringing that out. And singers who sing to that, they really rely on that backbeat in order to express themselves. Soul is bringing in the emotional parts of your singing, what the pain and the blues and everything that what that means to you. Okay?
Mm-hmm. Charles, please.
Yeah, I'm interested in knowing the cultural and historical influences that inspired jazz.
Yeah, well, naturally, the cultural influences that inspired jazz are the influence from the stolen Africans that were taken to the United States about 400 years ago, the African Americans which live there now. Through this culture, through the experiences that they experienced in the under the slave trade and during the slave movement up until the emancipation and beyond, these experiences grew and built into a form of culture, a form of art scene that they call the Phil Hollers. They're doing through planning and singing. From this comes through the blues, the so-called blues. And at the beginning times, this was the time when each individual was capable of singing the blues. And everyone understood that everybody had this blues and they could sing it. And then as the time went on into the early 1900s, the form of this blues changed a little to become done on the stage and theater during the minstrels times. And from this, at this same moment, this so-called music they call jazz, which is, for me, is not a very nice category, but it's the category we use now, sprung up. And that, what I believe, was the historical and cultural influences.
Comments?
No, I don't have anything more to add to that. Okay. I think we can go to the next question. Yeah. Actually, right.
How is jazz to be compared to the so-called serious or classical music?
Well, I think in order to answer that, one will first have to define what we mean by serious. Because as we discussed before, we are labeling here. We are labeling in terms of bad connotation, good connotation, like what's worth more, what's more accepted by society. And in German, we actually make the distinction between ernste Musik and Unterhaltungsmusik, but putting more cultural emphasis and more value and more importance on the ernste Musik, which I feel is not right and is not fair, because to me, jazz actually is like Black American classical music. That's what it is to me. And it deserves the same value and the same support that classical music is getting. Like the Opera House in Berlin is subsidized, I don't know by how much every year, but I don't know of one concert hall in Berlin that specializes on jazz and that provides a platform for jazz artists and gives that kind of promotion, financial promotion.
Okay. Now, would you then define serious music or classical music? Formally define it.
How would I formally define
it? Yeah, yes.
Well, to me, music is something that comes from the individual, and it has to do with how much work you put in as the individual. And I'm a jazz singer, and I take my work very serious. I mean, what is serious? Is it comic, or what is it? To me, it is the work that you put into your field, the dedication, and the talent. And to me, there is no difference between the classical and the jazz. Like, actually, if you go back, classical music, when it first developed years, centuries ago, those musicians were improvising. They had actually jam sessions just like jazz musicians. It's just not too many people know about this today. But when Mozart played, he improvised, and they had contests. They got together and improvised. But it became a certain norm, because then music was notated, and a certain improvisation became a sonata or a fugue or whatever, and then we play it today. But that's how jazz pieces developed also.
Okay.
Well, tell me, while we're developing music and all these other things, what are some of the economic realities that are associated with composing or playing this music?
Well, I think that most people that pursue jazz don't do it for the money. They do it for the love. They know that their future is not going to be guaranteed with millions of dollars or millions of marks.
That's right.
I can't say that for other types of music, but one of the economic realities is that you might not be rich and famous. You might be famous and not rich. You might not become a multimillionaire pursuing jazz, but you do it because you love the culture of it and you love the feeling of it.
What are the realities of playing jazz, the economic realities of playing jazz in Berlin or in Europe so far for the group of you?
Well, I think Connie touched on one phase of it. It's certain institutions, especially here in Germany, are supported by the government with government money. And well, you know, the Deutsche Oper or the classical music scene, and the jazz scene is not supported by the government. And so whatever we have to struggle for ourselves. We have to make sure that we get enough jobs, that and that makes it more difficult for us to make a living at it than, say, somebody who is, what do you call it, Beamter in Philharmonie.
Yeah, most of us are not only making money, are only making money playing jazz. We have to do a lot of different kind of music, so a lot of different types of performances.
That's
which
true.
Can include other kinds of funk groups, blues groups, theater,
pop,
dance
everything.
Groups, everything, just to survive. But as a jazz musician and playing only jazz, it's very difficult, I think, not just here in Berlin, but also in the rest of the world.
Charles.
There are those people from racial backgrounds who feel there is specific music to be portrayed by designated racial groups. How do you feel or respond to this issue?
Anybody?
Well, okay, I guess I have something to say to that. My situation is pretty different over here, being German, being white, and being a jazz singer. And I think I'm experiencing a little bit what Marian Anderson experienced or Paul Robeson experienced in their days when they made it into the opera houses. And for me, it's sometimes pretty difficult because people walk up to me and ask me, why do you sing jazz? You're German, you're white, do you have the right voice for this? Or, you know, you don't have the background. And I've also been outright attacked by different people for singing jazz. But I believe that, to me, jazz is one of the most democratic art forms in this world. And so I just go ahead and do what I feel comes from my heart, and I try to just go my way. Period. But I think it's sometimes pretty difficult.
Further questions?
As a player, when I play, I would like to be surrounded with the best musicians.
Right.
It doesn't help me if I'm playing with all black musicians and the feeling's not there. And that happens quite a lot sometimes. Just because everybody's black doesn't mean everything's happening. So. You want the best. If you're getting ready to be operated on, and the doctor's getting ready to put the scalpel, so you want him to be the best doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same thing in music. It's a double-edged sword. Some of the rules that you have for applying certain racial quotas or certain racial preferences can backfire on you. And what's good for some people are not good for everybody.
Yeah, I don't think there are any cultural boundaries to what you to music or to sports or anything like that. I mean, if you feel pulled to a certain type of music, I'm sure there would be many, many more American blacks playing in symphony orchestras if they were given an opportunity years ago to study instruments. And I'm sure that we would be a lot more white blues singers and players if they were given an opportunity. Mm-hmm. So it is no cultural limitations, it's just a social and limitation that we set on ourselves.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Social and nationalist, because I mean, there are people who are Chinese and they do Chinese music and they want white Europeans playing authentic Chinese music or Brazilian music or Tibetan music. I mean, music should be in itself open. It's a universal language, and it could be taught and learned by all peoples of the planet. And so the jazz, in the same respect, can also be performed and played by everyone. But of course, like Reggie said, you should have the best musicians around you, no matter what it is.
Timber.
How much of a factor is the culture determinant in regards to excellence of a player-composer, or the lack of thereof?
Well, I would say culture is nearly everything, from what you get, and it goes back to what Fawazi was saying, of anybody can play jazz, but you have to get into it. It's your experiences that make you what that is. So if you hear a record, maybe you hear a record and you're young and you get turned on, you want to get more records and you keep going, and you have your culture then. You get into the jazz culture, you become a jazz musician, you look for your teachers and listen to your masters.
Further comments?
Well, thank you very much. And now we will go to our arts calendar. And remember, you are participating in the Collegium. Thank you.
bell round midnight, round midnight. I do pretty well till after sundown. Supper time, I'm feeling sad, but it really gets bad round midnight. Memories always start around midnight, around midnight. Haven't got the heart to stand those memories when my heart.
Oh,
Hello, and welcome to our State of Affairs portion of the program, where we're very pleased to enjoy a conversation with Brother Mr. Michael Clifton. Michael, good heavens, welcome to the Collegium.
Been a long time, man.
Surely has, Michael. What have you been doing since the last time we met and spoke and did stuff?
Many, many things.
Okay, let's hear the good stuff first.
Well, I got involved with playing and, as you know, playing drums around town, meeting all the cats, playing jazz, doing this, doing that, and finally I got into the Chameleon when the wall came down.
Interesting.
Got in the Chameleon Variety Theater.
Right.
And I've always been in love with the circus and playing for jugglers.
Oh.
I play for some of the best jugglers in the world, man. And I met him, you know, I got involved with that through the Chameleon. A woman named Nancy got me in there. I had a tour with Al Gray. I said, I can't go down there. She said, we really need a drummer. There was four, they had a Damen Capella down there without a drummer. She said, the show is great, the people are great, you're going to love the place, but we need a drummer desperately. I said, I can't do it. I'm set up with Al Gray, great jazz tour, you know.
Exactly.
And just come down and look at it.
Okay.
Just come down, you're gonna dig it, man.
Right.
So I went down there, fell in love with the place.
Really?
Yeah. Canceled Al Gray and went on and got in the Chameleon Theater. And since then, it's been like I've expanded my horizon, so to speak.
Oh, that's interesting.
Became not only a drummer, but a variety artist, they call it.
Okay.
And, you know, a little clowning, a little juggling.
Right.
A little tap dancing.
Right.
And it worked out to where I, you know, just ideas come, and I actually made things that I could put on my body and play. And started with the Pinocchio outfit, playing with the sticks and playing myself. And then I went to with thimbles on my fingers, and now I play, and what it's called now is dirty dancing drums. So I got tits and I got everything there, and I play and I dance, and so I'm kind of a clown slash drummer musician. I've gotten into country music, and you know, I come and sing my country songs and play the harmonica, write songs, and
wow.
I have no problem playing on the street in the morning and playing in the Philharmonic at night. Doesn't matter to me.
Right.
You know?
What have you learned, Michael, from your experiences playing with different types of performers, different presentations? I mean, as you talked about Al Gray, and then you've worked with a number of the musicians here. So what did you learn from there, those experiences, that would contribute to your experience at the Chameleon? How did that work out? How did you make that blending?
You know, from the older guys.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Oh, man. I learned so much from them.
Name them. Tell the people about that.
Earl Bostic.
Yeah.
Carnell Lyons, the great tap dancer.
Yeah.
You know, showtime.
Yeah, yeah.
Very learned so much from him.
Because there's a lot of things in dances. This is what you call a crimp. Now, we're in New York now. Now, this was a great act called and Toe. It was Raymond Winfield, and he brought up the slides. And this is a step that he taught me, and it went like this.
first dancer, teacher that I had, because I never went to a school to dance, we dancing out in the street, and I was wearing out all my shoes on the concrete dancing. And this was Harvey Collins.
Earl Bostick,
yeah.
Carnell Lyons, the great tap dancer.
Yeah.
You know, showtime. And just being around these people was just amazing, you know, doing shows with the older Russell Bobby Evans, you know,
yeah.
who worked with Billie Holiday,
yeah. oh,
you know, way back in the Cha-Cha Club, where John Hammond came and so-called discovered her.
Yeah.
I mean, he was just doing a duet with her back then.
Yeah.
And everybody was coming in there. And so, you know, sitting around, Benny Bailey's in the show, and Russell Bobby Evans is talking, and we're eating dinner after we're working every night, you know, in the supper club. And, you know, the stories that come from these older gentlemen. It's just priceless, working with Jimmy Woody, Duke Ellington's bass player.
Right.
And they love to speak, and they love to reminisce. And you, as a youngster, can just sit there and absorb it all, you know?
Right.
And it's so inspiring.
Right.
And so giving life to me and seeing that I want to be like that. I want to be show business, you know, where you don't only play,
mm-hmm.
but it's a part of doing everything. That means comedy, telling jokes, singing songs, dance a little dance,
mm-hmm.
do some juggling, do whatever you can to entertain the people, you know?
As a young man coming along, a young artist, I mean, what advice would you give to people, the young artists that are coming along now, and you're encountering these various people, how do you know to whom you should listen? How do you know how to distinguish between something that's going to be constructive, helpful?
You mean listening to them?
The people that you, the artist, or the people that you come in contact with, or people that are giving you advice. We spoke about Bob Harrell, for instance, people like that. Who do you know that, how do you know which one's putting you on the right track? How do you have that perception?
From the young ones?
As a young man meeting these older people, how did you know to whom to listen?
Well, that was just, you know, a matter of instinct. And, you know, the people, the guys are magic, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And being on stage with them, they're just, is 50% of it. Because being off stage with them is the thing, you know, just being in the back room with them. When they start to tell these stories,
yes.
and everything, and they get really loose. And like I said, it was working with the jazz masters, it was very little actual practical, I mean, rehearsal and stuff like that. They didn't do that much.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you went on stage and played, and the stories that came after was the learning part from, you know, what they went through,
mm-hmm.
and talking about their idols,
mm-hmm.
Duke Ellington, Count Basie,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, all the other people that they had played with.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy Woody was just influenced so much from mm-hmm. Duke Ellington. He spoke like Duke Ellington, you know?
Ah, interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And he was very elegant and very, very gentleman person.
Coming from the United States, where I've heard other musicians, and from my own experience, the emphasis was always on rehearsal, really great rehearsal, strict rehearsal, so that you really knew what you were going to do when you stepped on stage. And coming to Europe, there was another approach to the matter.
Yes, yes.
How did you find that, and how did you deal with that?
Well, I liked it.
Okay.
You know, it's more spontaneous.
Yeah.
It was more free.
Yeah.
I also felt in Europe that they didn't discriminate so much they were open more to different levels of musicians. And when you went to the jam sessions, man, it could be anything could happen there, you know? And I just felt it, particularly in Berlin,
yeah,
such a freedom here, musically, artistically,
yes,
spiritually, being, you know, with the police, with in every aspect. I mean, man, we would, like with Bob, you know, we yeah would, the joints were open all night, man.
Yeah.
You know, we would start our breakfast set at 6 o'clock in the morning.
Good heavens.
And like I said, playing Night Tunisia with the beat.
Yeah.
You know, and letting the last of the disco people wind away, and the early morning jazz people coming from another joints, yeah, coming in and getting their jazz brunch, you know, with real American.
Yeah.
Bob would go out and he'd throw down, man. He'd get biscuits and gravy and
yeah
the whole deal. And we'd ease on more and more into the jazz, real
talk
jazz
of the town.
You know, talk of the town.
Yeah.
We were sleeping down there with me and three other musicians.
Right.
We didn't even have sleeping bags. We were all sleeping like that together with our coats on. And he gave us the, you know, that nightclub to sleep in. He knew we were good musicians, but we need a little help.
Yeah, sure.
He put us up.
Yeah. Yeah.
He got his band uniforms.
Yeah.
He said, I got this idea at 6 to 10 on Saturday morning,
right,
or 6 to 12
yeah
Saturday morning. And then he gave us another jobs on top of that.
Right.
And, you know, he's the one that introduced me to you.
Yeah,
I was
exactly
driving,
right,
you know, the car.
Yes.
They ended up going to Fountainhead. You
yeah
were, you had a dance performance down
yeah
in Munich.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he connected me with a lot of people, man.
Wonderful man.
Wonderful man. And the freedom of Berlin back in those days was, still is. I mean, it's still free. It's the last of the Bohemias, I call it.
Michael, why do you think during that period, when it was West Berlin,
mm-hmm,
why do you think, what contributed to the fact that the freedom that you're talking about, and I've often heard West Berlin referred to as an oasis. What were the
facts? Well, it was an island.
Okay, okay. But it was an island, and what were the influences that gave it the flavors that you're referring to, in your opinion?
It was an oasis, Donald, because, well, Berlin, the city of sin. You never come out the way you went in.
Oh, that's something to look forward
and
to.
And I certainly didn't.
Oh, okay. Famous last words, right?
That's right. And those words have been quoted, as a matter of fact. I, you know, it was a place where a lot of the Brazilian people and Africans I was playing with didn't even leave the city, because they got in and then their visa expired or whatever.
Oh.
And then they never left. So you couldn't even go on tour with these people,
mm-hmm,
because they'd have to have a passport to
yeah
get out.
Yeah.
And they had been there for years and years, man. And, you know, it was just a place where everything, I got exposed to everything, like I said, Brazilian music, African music, cowboy music, and Indian music.
Mm-hmm,
I'm talking
mm-hmm
about India, you
mm-hmm
know?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I study that. I play Carnatic music from southern India.
Mm-hmm.
And I met my first, I'm from Denver, Colorado.
Mm-hmm.
I was influenced by country music, but I met my first real cowboys in Berlin, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the real, trying to play
John Wayne and
country, well, trying to play country music and being in that scene. It was
yeah, sure.
It was little clubs and little scenes, you know.
Yeah.
And they just mixed all kinds of things together, you know.
And what about now? What's the difference between, say, the current times and what you're referring to back in the day?
Man.
How has it changed?
Well,
why?
you know, we still got them. We still got our places. Mm-hmm. And we still keep it alive. And I'm still at the B flat on Wednesday nights doing the best I can with the younger musicians, man. I mean, what has changed is, what has changed? I mean, there's a million more musicians now than there was back then. Right. We used to run, literally run from job to job back then, you know?
Yes.
You could have five jobs in a weekend or even six, you know? You could be running like crazy, man.
Right.
And yeah, there's a lot more musicians now and not so many. I mean, there's places to play. And it is still a bohemia, but it's not like back then, man, it was special. I mean, it was just, it was a small island, an oasis, mm-hmm. that was very politically, very isolated, mm-hmm. and also gave me my first looks. I was an ignorant American. I didn't know anything about politics or East or West or anything. I was fortunate enough to go with the East-West projects, people from DDR, mm-hmm. bringing like two musicians from West to play with two musicians from the DDR, mm-hmm. and that was me and Hans Hartmann. We'd go over, and play with you know, Connie Bauer you know, somebody else in the East, and so that was my whole lightning of politics and what it is and what is this, why is this, you go through a Checkpoint Charlie and you end up on the other side and it's completely different. It's mm-hmm. the same city, mm-hmm. and we went over there for several longer stays, mm-hmm. maybe you'd have a tour of 22 days and you'd you only work 17 of those days, right. Those days off I was only, you know, a few meters from my home. I lived in Tiergarten.
Uh-huh, right.
But it was like being in another world. You couldn't phone.
Yeah.
You couldn't. I couldn't even phone my to make my gig straight. I could phone my mother in Denver, but the lines were always cut to West Berlin, mm-hmm. and you could walk to the Brandenburg Gate, mm-hmm. practically see your house. Mm-hmm. But it was a different world, man. And being here in Berlin at that time, I mean, it just opened my head up so much, man.
Right.
To, you know, there, I met so many beautiful people from the East.
Right.
And when the wall came down, of course, they all had my address.
Of course.
And I mean, everybody from policemen all the way down ended up finding my house.
Oh, good.
You know, and coming and saying hello.
That's interesting. Michael, when you would return to the United States, or when people from the States would come and visit you, how would you help to inform them about your experiences in another part of the world, like, and bringing something to them that they probably knew little about or had another perspective because of the information that was brought to them? How did you handle that, Michael?
Well, first, you know, I have a lot of bicycles at my house.
Oh, okay.
So I put them on a bicycle.
Keep them in shape.
We go riding around Berlin.
Okay.
And I'd show them Berlin.
Okay.
And the beautiful places that we have here and the greenness of it all.
Okay.
And I've never been in such a green place, and, you know, take them swimming.
Yes.
And take them to the nightclubs.
Right.
And be out all night and be free, be safe. People from the United States, they had a good time when they came to Michael Clifton's house.
Oh, that's it. And what did they think about, like, with the DDR and well, East Berlin? How did they feel about that?
I'd take them there, and, you know, if I wasn't a guest to come in and play there, then we'd have to go, you'd pay 25...
Deutsche
Marks.
Deutsche Marks, yeah.
And then you could go and stay till midnight there.
Ah,
and so, I, you know, and I'd take them around there and tell them my experiences of being there.
Right.
It's much different when you're a guest there. I was making good money in the DDR.
Okay.
You know, because they were paying about 1 to 1. So I was getting what a school teacher, I mean, I was getting about 600 or 700 marks a night there.
Good heavens, your cup runneth over.
Oh, yes, it did. I had a big bank account there, but gave it all away.
Yeah,
and
sure.
It was a pleasure
I can
to
imagine.
Give it to the people there.
Yeah.
And just friends I knew and meeting people over there where I knew their mother over here.
Yeah.
But, you know, the mother and father had split.
Yeah.
And
yeah. Yeah.
The mother works at a recording studio. I meet the drummer over there, and I find out, well, I know your mother, man.
Wow.
You know, I go to the recording studio.
Right.
And he shows me all the pictures.
Right.
Yeah, I know her.
Right.
So it's just being able to give those people money, and eventually they got out.
Yeah.
My manager, who was in the DDR, eventually got out and became the manager of Jazz Keller in Frankfurt, which is the oldest jazz club in Germany,
right.
About 50 years old.
Right, right. Michael, what have you learned these few summers that you could share with the young folks coming along? What philosophical or points of view or perspectives could you present to them that might help them stumble through or maybe glide through? They say, you know, how do I do this? Which way is up, as Richard Pryor said?
Perseverance.
Mm-hmm. Okay, perseverance.
Look on the lighter side.
Yes.
You know, keep your humor.
Yes.
Keep your eyes open.
Yes.
Keep your ears open. That means don't only go for one kind of music. Think about you're in an international city with all kinds of musics.
Mm-hmm.
People from everywhere, you know, there's so much to grasp in Berlin. Keep your ears open. Be involved with people. Be involved with the scene. Don't stay in your house and practice and practice and practice all the time. Get out there and meet people and bring them to your house.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Bring Africans. Bring South Americans, bring, you know, all the Iranians, all the different kind of musics is in Berlin.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's not only about our great art form, American jazz, you know, it's about mixing it all together and getting all these influences.
Mm-hmm.
And you can always mix it with your jazz then, you know? And all these people, by the way, you know, jazz is a culture. So, if you can dig it, I mean, if you can dig it and study it, you got it. You know, you can be from Russia,
yeah,
or from anywhere,
right,
and play good jazz.
Right.
So, I would say just keep keep all those ideas open. Be free. Be open and get around. Keep your eyes and ears open.
Could we bring, or could you bring this point of view, say to President Putin, or to President Obama, or to different people who are involved with politics and addressing the issues that confront so many people in the world? What could you tell them, and what could they learn from the point of view that you've just expressed? And how might that help to bring better or peace in the world in which we live?
Well, music,
mm-hmm,
as you know, Don,
yeah,
is a great medium for peace,
mm-hmm,
especially songs with words.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And, you know, Bob Dylan and everybody, mm-hmm, said it. So, you know, John Lennon, Imagine, man.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they were, as you know,
mm-hmm,
what just happened in Paris.
Yes.
And, you know, the guy the next day is out on the street playing Imagine,
mm-hmm,
how it would be without these wars, without these religions.
Mm-hmm.
And so music is, I think, you know, to Putin or to Barack Obama or to anyone who's into politics, they know the power of this song.
Mm-hmm.
So I would just say, let the world write peace songs, man, and let them be sung from Woody Guthrie on up, you know, and through, keep going, keep inventing your own songs.
And how significant is this approach, do you think, to children, to bringing the music into the schools?
Oh, extremely significant. Should be always in the schools. I mean, the kids are everything. That's why I want to keep living, man, is to so I can teach the kids and have fun with the kids and influence the kids. The kids are our seeds that are going to be our trees. You know, and they're gonna go on and influence other generations. So to have that in the schools, or to have people involved with the children, and let them get involved with singing, with dancing, with creating things with instruments, is highly important. And I pray to God that I will be able to do that a little bit longer. I mean, I will be able to do that. It's something I've always done on my travels through India, through Asia, South America. I always get involved with the kids and the street kids and get them playing. But I want to, yeah, this is my dream, man, is to influence the children, our seeds.
Well, Michael, with your history and with your background and with all of the persons that always speak so highly of you, I am certain that no matter what, your history will be maintained, brother.
Thank you, Brother Donald. Thank you.
Thank you. So stay with us, and remember, you are participating in what else but the Collegium.